Finally, I'll be able to gauge the size of the internet. Wait. Oh, crap.
Is this thing even on? Hello everyone, my name is Legally Crazy Carl, once again. Now today we'll be talking about how you fools let a computer worm be released from your own campus. But first, a little background.
Hey, buddy, I'm only here for the GMOs.
Sir, I must politely ask you to shut your mouth! Now then, on to the lesson. This fine-looking specimen is Robert Tappan Morris, a computer scientist and professor. He is responsible for the Morris worm, an experiment which failed and became marred in tragedy. Morris was born in 1965 in Long Hill Township, New Jersey, to loving parents Robert Morris and Anne Farlow Morris. His father was a computer scientist at Bell Labs. He helped design the very system Unix that his son would hack. Morris Sr. also went on to become chief scientist at the National Computer Security Center, a division of the
NSA.
Now, as a strapping young man, Morris went to Harvard University. When that was all done and good, he started graduate school at Cornell University. Now, this is when things get juicy. Oh, good heavens, how did that get on here? The Morris worm Robert created was released on November 2nd, 1988, while he was still in graduate school. Morris released the worm on your campus, idiots. He released it from MIT so that everyone would believe the person who released the worm was a student there. However, Morris claims he had no ill intentions and was simply trying to run an experiment to gauge the size of
the internet!
Well, that took quite a lot out of me. Take the rest away, Mr. Narrator.
Alright, Carl, you lazy old fart. Firstly, let's talk about the virus itself. It took advantage of Unix Sendmail, an email client which had relatively low security at this time. Specifically, it utilized a hole in the Unix debug system. Also, the finger protocol was definitely exploited. It was the basic network protocols for human info and human-related status. The command RSH reexec was taken advantage of as well. This command can send unprotected and unencrypted info over networks, including passwords. A buffer overrun hole in the fingered network service was used too. Also, the weak passwords didn't help keep anyone safe. The worm had been programmed to scan each computer it discovered to see if the virus was already on it. In theory, everyone could just run a process that would claim yes to keep the virus from installing. However, Morris had compensated for this by directing the worm to copy itself even if the user's response was yes one out of seven instances. This small addition proved overzealous as the worm spread incredibly quickly and copied itself multiple times on the same computers. Overall, the virus had catastrophic results.
Alright, ladies and gentlemen. That generous man in the front row gave me some delicious GMOs, so now I am back in action. Now then, where were we?
Well, I was just about to discuss the effects of the Morris worm, although you should probably do it, as my daughter has a soccer game that I promised to drive her to.
Daddy, are we going to the game?
Of course, sweetie. Bye, MIT lamos.
Chill out!
Thanks. Now let's move on to the effects of the worm.
Yo, Carl, give me back my GMOs!
After the show, John. Anyway, The worm influenced DARPA,
the Defense Advanced Research Projects Agency,
to fund CERT-CC,
the Computer Emergency Response Team Communications Center.
Also, Gene Stafford started up the phage mailing list to aid in computer and technological emergencies. In 1989, Robert Tappan Morse was tried and convicted of infraction of U.S. Code Title 18, the Computer Fraud and Abuse Act, established 3 years prior in 1986. He was sentenced to 3 years of probation, a fine of $10,050, and 400 hours of community service. In addition, he was also fined more money for the cost of his supervision.
Now that's all true, but I did do some pretty amazing stuff after leaving the slammer, you know.
Gasp! It's Robert Morris!
That's right, my possibly intoxicated friend. I started a company called VioWeb in 1995. It was for creating your own online store. I then sold it to Yahoo in 1998. They renamed it the Yahoo Store. Pretty dumb, if you ask me. Also, I became a professor here at MIT in 1999. One final point. I received the Mark Weiser Award in 2010. That's named after the computer scientist and programmer of the same name.
Thank you, Mr. Morris. Now, if you'll excuse me, I must get out of this dump. It smells like codfish and entitlement.
Get him, my minions!
Were we supposed to go with them or something?
I don't know.
Give the GMOs back, Carl.
Fine. You want them back? You can have them.